is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 7, Deadbeat, Chapters 13, 14, and 15. In these chapters, Harry goes to a crime scene at the Field Museum, and it's really gross. What does it mean? Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder! As gross as the first book where there are people's ribs ripped open, though.
It was pretty bad, though.
I'll say that.
I mean, at one point, there was a plastic baggie next to the body.
Yeah.
Other body parts in it. It's pretty bad.
Yeah. Yeah, he didn't, at least didn't have to see that part. He gets reported to him secondhand.
Right, yeah. it was grisly.
Welcome to the show, everyone. I'm Natasha.
I'm RoShawn.
And, I hope you guys can all forgive me because I spent the half hour before we started recording trying to think up a catchy name for a panel, never got a satisfying, like, solution to that, and then was so distracted when I started this episode that I flubbed the intro and had to start over. So RoShawn kind of wants to kill me. It's fine. I'm used to it. So yeah, these three. What did you think here, and what were you expecting, and was this it? Because, honestly, so much of this book, like, I have it out of order how certain things happen, that when I went and listened to these episodes on the audiobook, I forgot that these were the next three chapters, and I had other expectations. I'm wondering, as a first-time reader, what you thought was coming. At this point.
Well, I was not expecting some of the stuff that we get in these chapters. For instance, we meet two new terrible things.
Yeah.
Which we're averaging about two terrible things per three chapters that we record on, right? I mean, first we met Gravain, and then we had the thing with Cal, and now we meet, I think her name is it Alicia?
Yeah, Alicia.
And her companion, Lee?
Lee Xiong.
So, that's awful.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what she is yet, but we find out that Lee is a ghoul, which I only know from Supernatural. But apparently it's the same sort of lore because he describes them exactly the same way and how they eat flesh and all that stuff. And it's gnarly and nasty and I didn't care for it.
Yep.
But we had the thing in the last episode where Dresden's car gets all fucked up, right?
Correct.
And it's a decidedly not a supernatural way to do it. Like someone just takes a bat to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I was kind of stumped on what that could be. And I had kind of thought, but I didn't say it. I thought about Marcone, but I was like, no, because I have no reason to believe that he has anything to do with what's going on right now. And even if I did, why would he be sending somebody to do such a low level thing like beat up,
right?
You know, the Beetle with a baseball bat. That seems particularly not his style. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So it was weird for me that we get a name drop. You know, he's mentioned in these chapters by way of this fucking cadaver.
Right.
This Eduardo person.
Mendoza.
Right? Every time I hear that name, all I can think of is The Simpsons.
Is there somebody named Mendoza in that?
There's a, you know, the McBain character?
No.
In The Simpsons? Sure you do. He's like the Arnold Schwarzenegger.
The Arnold Schwarzenegger.
No? Oh, my God. Owen. Somewhere across the universe, you can feel my silent tears.
oh, Yeah, no, okay. I think it's ringing a bell for me now.
But, so the McBain character in The Simpsons, his villain that he's always fighting in his movies is named Mendoza.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
But, all right. So, but about these chapters.
Yeah.
So to answer your question, yes, no, and no.
Okay, good. Good talk. Well, thanks everybody. And we will see you next week with 3 more chapters. I'm sure that you enjoy our very in-depth coverage. Yeah, so, all right. He starts off looking for the magical spots that Morty Lindquist's ghosts pointed out for him on this map that he's got in his pocket. And he goes, the first place that he visits, I think, is that street named Whacker, which I just love that the street's named Whacker.
All right. So, okay, yeah, I was on the wrong chapter. So you're right. So the first thing he does is he goes out walking to Whacker Street, which is, you're right, is unfortunately named.
In the Dark Tower book that we're reading now, there's a woman who is a widow, and her last name is Smack, and they call her the Widow Smack, and I can't. That's all I'm going to say about that. So we're on Whacker Street, and he finds the cold spot, but when he like goes and asks around and investigates what happened, nobody has an answer for him.
It's like in a real sort of like business district that shuts down at like 6 o'clock. Nobody was out last night. They don't know what the fuck happened there. I also like that he has to pay like a small fortune to park.
Yes, because he's got this giant fucking car now.
And throughout these 3 chapters, he talks about how much this is costing him.
Yep.
He has to park twice and then like whatever the admission is into the museum later.
Yeah, he's like, is it going to get so that I can't afford to protect the city from evil anymore? That'd be embarrassing. And I'm like, I feel you. So, yeah, he finally, like, I actually like because he talks about how he, like, asks everybody and nobody saw anything and it took a bunch of time. And it made me think of that scene in The Wire where it's just a montage of them, like, asking people door to door all these questions and everybody having nothing to contribute and doors slamming in their face.
Right. And there's nothing you could do but keep asking.
Yep. And, like, that's the whole thing. Like, I liked that in The Wire, they go out of their way to make sure that we understand that's, like, what the job is.
Mm-hmm.
Versus in a lot of media, when the perfect witness just happens to, like, be standing near them when they're talking about something and is like, oh, I saw that guy. This looks like so-and-so, you know, whatever.
Law and Order, I'm looking at you. Even Harry has a line where he talks about, you know, all this time he spent is just, like, asking people, and he says the cure for it is to do more looking.
Yeah.
Which is really all you can do.
Yep. So he finally makes his way over to the Field Museum, and he can tell immediately that something is up. Because when he walks in, there's some security guard getting questioned by 2 police officers.
Yeah.
And he tries to, like, be casual, but he's a 6'6" tall man in a leather duster.
Right.
I'm imagining that he is hard to miss and hard to mistake for someone else.
And we find out later that it's absolutely true.
Yep.
I want to say that he talks about the main attraction at the Field Museum as being Sue.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she has a Twitter account.
I would not be surprised by that.
I think, like, the murderous raptor or something.
She's a T-Rex.
Yeah, that's what's confusing to me because I wish I had fucking a way to get in my Twitter real quick. But because of when these books were written, I don't know if that was a mistake on his part.
What was a mistake?
Like, he just calls her a T-Rex, and I don't know if
No, she is Sue the T-Rex Field Museum. As the largest and most complete Tyrannosaurus Rex skeleton ever found, Sue is a vital fossil specimen to the paleontological community. Paleontological. Is that a word?
Close enough.
Most extensive and best preserved specimen at over 90% recovered bulk. So, yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, I can't find it. And mostly because I don't feel like looking up how to spell Tyrannosaurus Rex.
That's fair.
There it is. Tyrannosaurus Rex. Oh, yeah, she does have a Twitter.
She does?
Yeah. Tyrannosaurus nice. Rex. I confused her with a different Sue Bones who has a Twitter.
Oh, okay.
But yeah. And I live at the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago. I'm like proper old, but I'm still fit, though.
Does it say that?
It says that.
That's amazing. Sue is British? How does that work?
It says... What her pinned tweet says, I'm a big girl, appreciate me.
Oh my god. I have big bones.
That's funny.
So yeah, Sue is the Field Museum. Like, I think that it's pretty famous because somebody commented on our last post on the in the patrons group with something called the Field Museum. Like, they couldn't, that's the what you said when they were talking about, like, spots of magic, and they just couldn't believe that you'd never heard of it before. But I haven't either, so, you know. Don't live in Chicago, I don't know what to tell you. I've barely heard of MoMA and the Met. and I've been to both. So, yeah, he goes inside and waits around until they go in opposite directions. And there's a couple cops who are, like, waiting for Rawlins, who's doing the interviewing, to come back and secure the scene so that they can take a break because they've been on duty for, like, 12 and a half hours straight. And they're so impatient that they finally decide to just leave the site alone because they've done so much documentation already that to them they're just like, what harm could possibly come of it? So they go out for smoke and lunch breaks, and Harry sneaks over to the room. He doesn't go inside. He's very careful about that. But he gets right up on the edge there and looks around. And it's a pretty gruesome scene.
Yeah.
And there's an interesting thing here where he found the cold energy on Wacker, but it didn't have this, like, greasy, nauseating quality that the magic surrounding Gravain had. And it didn't have the same feel as the magic here at the Field Museum has either. And right. He can't really figure that out, why they seem to have such different qualities to them.
Is this where he starts to talk about how you can't exactly trace, you know, like, how magic feels to a particular wizard, but there's what does he say? Shit. Sorry.
I'm like not sure what you.
He has a little moment to himself where he just, and he's talking about how terrible this all smells. This is mostly about blood.
Oh, when he's talking about the smell of death, and that it's not its own smell. It's like a collection of smells.
Yeah, that too. But this was more about, like, how the energy feels around, like, the different scenes, like you were just talking about.
Okay.
And he was sort of explaining how you can't, it's not like he could notice the energy in a particular place and be like, oh, this belongs to so-and-so. You know, like, it's not that exact.
I got you. Yeah.
But
there are certain qualities.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Here, the magical workings didn't leave behind an exact fingerprint that could be used to trace to a given wizard. But intuition told me that this working had been sloppier and more frenetic than something that Gervain would have done, but messier than something Cal would prefer.
Gotcha, right.
So it's like a sense of the person who's working the magic, even not like the particular person, but almost like the type of magic that they would use.
And he says that there's a malicious glee in that somebody used their magic to kill a person and they loved doing it.
Yep. And he talks about how strong this magic is. Mm-hmm. So this is like each time he encounters this magic so far in this book, one of the things that he's thought to himself is, holy shit, this is some powerful stuff.
Yeah.
Like, each time. and this is still relatively the beginning of the book, you know? Mm-hmm. We're not even halfway through yet. And he's meeting, they're not if they're people or not, but he's meeting practitioners that are, like, serious business.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't think we've ever started a book with him running into, you know, this level of power each time.
Yeah, I think you're right. Like, it's mostly been, I don't even know who I'm up against necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's, like, getting a sense of who the enemy is, and that's the... But this is, like, he kind of knows who the people are by this point, and they're all badasses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, this is before we even... Like, this is right around the time he finds out about... Because he bumps into that cop, right? That cop comes downstairs.
Right, Rawlins.
And, drops a really interesting tidbit that I'm assuming we knew Murphy's dad was a cop, but mm-hmm. we talked about this last time too, about whether or not we knew he was dead or not. Did I know that Murphy's dad was an SI?
Yeah. Or just when we talked about it last time and talked about how it's like implied because he talks to Murphy's mom and we hear from Murphy herself before we even meet her mom that she says, my dad used to do this and my mom doesn't like what I do. And there's like, I think I need to find it. But I feel like when he talks to her mom says something about how the job got to be too much for him.
Yeah.
So yeah, we definitely knew that he used to do exactly what Murphy does.
See, I think I think either I forgot or I maybe never put it together that her dad specifically was out hunting monsters.
Okay.
Right. I knew he was a cop, but I don't think I realized that he was doing the exact type of work that Karen was doing.
I think it's not like, it's just assumed that if you are the head of SI, this is what you wind up doing.
Hmm.
Because there's no avoiding it. That's what SI is they deal with the shit that has no explanation.
Right, yeah, that's what I mean. Like, I don't know if I realized that he was in SI. I think I just thought he was a cop.
Okay.
Because when Rawlins tells a story, you know, to Dresden, and basically it's the Karen's dad saved him from, I'm assuming a vampire, something that burned up when the sun came up.
Mm-hmm.
But he stops it with a rifle filled with rock salt.
Right.
Which actually wouldn't work on a vampire, so I don't know what the fuck it was.
Yeah, I'm wondering if that wasn't a ghoul. Can ghouls go out in daylight? I guess they can, because Lee Sean is walking around.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that whole rifle full of rock salt, so that's like such a supernatural thing. So either I just wasn't paying attention or I wasn't connecting the dots, because when that little tidbit dropped, I was like, oh, word?
Although I'm looking at this, I went to the Dresden Files wiki, and I know that there are people listening who know this and are probably yelling at us right now. But it says, the work got to him, he grew distant and started to drink a lot. Karen never knew of his prior work, her mother never having told her. And there's a little, like, reference number, and when I click that, it just says blood rights.
Hmm.
So, maybe Karen didn't know that he was doing exactly what she used to do?
Well, see, that's what's so weird to me, because now, as an adult in the Force...
How do people not mention that?
Exactly. How does she not know that at this point? But just because she knows it doesn't mean that it's ever actually come up, like, explicitly.
Mm-hmm.
So, as a reader, that's what I'm being. I don't remember ever it being like, oh, yeah, my dad was an SI, and now I'm an SI, and people give me shit about it because I'm not as good as my dad, or... know, or they think that I only got the job because of my dad, you know, or anything like that. Which seems like something that would be something she would have to deal with, not to get us too far off track. But, right? Am I crazy?
No, you're not crazy. And I'm just wishing that I could remember. Somebody, if you can, who knows better, like, what happened and who knew what, get in touch with me. Because I'll have to go back through blood rights to find that that conversation again. And it's hard for me to keep track of what we find out when and not, like, inadvertently dip into spoiler territory.
Oh, yeah, that's true. All right.
So I don't want to, like, start talking out of my ass here.
Right. Okay, well, so not so much for an answer, but just as to think about, like, Karen Murphy is doing the exact same job her father did. And we know she deals with a lot of bullshit because her department doesn't get any real respect. But, and because she's a woman. But the weight of, like, trying to fill her dad's shoes must really be something.
Yeah.
I hope she talks to Harry about that in the future so I can hear a little bit more about that.
Yeah, because this is kind of, you know, you're asking good character questions here, and I feel like I'm kind of on the fence as to whether she hasn't talked about it to Harry because it's like a difficult thing to talk about, or does she just not know?
Right.
I actually found, I'm trying to find the section where he has that conversation, but it seems, do you remember if he talks to her mom before or after the blow up with her sister dating her ex-husband?
I think it's after the blow up.
Oh yeah. Cause Murphy's mom was taller than her daughter. So we get the description of what she's like. And this is where her mom seems to be like very approving of Harry. Mm-hmm. In that way, because he sticks up to her and tells her to just get it, like, because this is when Karen wants to call the cops and get them involved in the thing with Mavra's scourge. Okay. And he says, she's been there for me too many times. I don't know if you're aware of how dangerous her job can be. The kinds of things she faces in special investigations can be especially difficult and disturbing. Mama Murphy was quiet for a moment before she said, before they established special investigations, the department routinely handed all those cases to senior detectives in the 13th precinct. The cases were referred to as black cat investigations, the detectives as black cats. And, of course, this is where things get broken. Some pages are omitted from this book preview. Because I used Google to, like, try and find this section. So it was not SI. It wasn't called SI.
Gotcha. This is very interesting.
Yeah.
And for me, again, because you guys know, as I read these books, you know, I tend to forget stuff and I make connections super late sometimes. Sometimes I make them way too early and then forget I've made that connection. So I like this, this seemingly small throwaway line to something in the past makes me excited to think, oh, there might be way more shit going on there that may come up, you know?
Yeah.
So Rawlins gives Harry the information on who the victim was.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Bartlesby? Which is a name I just can't take seriously, but I don't know why.
I think it is Dr. Bartlesby, yes.
It's something about it.
I like that one of the cops calls him Mr. and the security guard is like, Doctor!
Right.
Thank you. Yeah.
And he's got two, like, graduate students or assistants or whatever, and gives Harry their names. And just says, oh, wait, what?
I'm sorry. I just found the rest of it.
Oh, okay.
The detective is black cats. I didn't know that, I said. She nodded. My husband was a black cat for 12 years. I frowned. Murphy never told me that. I never told her. And Karen never knew her father very well. He was away so much of the time, and he died when she was only 11. Line of duty? Mama Murphy shook her head. The work got to him. He grew distant and started to drink too much. And one night at his desk, he took his own life.
No, he didn't. Oh, sorry. Yeah, okay.
Well, if he didn't, doing it at the desk at a police precinct is real ballsy.
Well, right at his desk. I mean, doing it, if he did it himself, doing it at his desk at work is still real ballsy.
That's true.
Okay.
I could see him being like, I don't want my family to find me, though. Let work dudes find me, and then they can just mop this vinyl floor.
Yeah, I mean, you could just go sit in your patrol car for all that action, though.
I think that'd be harder to clean, wouldn't it? I'm over here thinking too practically, though. People still throw themselves in front of trains, and I just don't understand that one.
Yeah. So, Harry wants to know if the assistants are, you know, suspects or not.
Mm-hmm.
And where are they now, pray tell?
Yeah.
And they can't, they're not answering their phones. They're not where they live. They're not, like, suspects, like, you know, there's evidence, but they're suspects in the sense of no one else here really knew him, and usually a victim is, you know, the victim of someone that knows them, so it makes sense that we would want to question them.
Yeah, I like that being that because, you know, when somebody gets murdered and then the other two people who seem like they were around a lot are also missing, my immediate thought is they are also victims.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, somebody... But it doesn't make sense if somebody is killed in this, like, enormously ceremonial manner.
Right.
That then they would go to the trouble to, like, hide the bodies of the other two people.
Right, right.
And then, yeah, that it's, you know, these are the only two people in town who knew who he was, and people don't usually kill strangers.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. A lot happened.
So, and, I mean, I guess it's possible the police could be like, oh, well, we just were very concerned about their whereabouts. We want to make sure they're safe.
Mm-hmm.
But that feels like more of a thing you say, right. Not really a thing you think.
Right. Agreed.
so, one last tidbit about this Rawlins guy is that he says he used to be a detective twice.
And he keeps getting bumped back down due to attitude problems.
For some reason, I really enjoyed that, and it was enough to make me hope that we see him again.
Yeah, I feel you on that. Yeah, because, you know, usually that shit is because of insubordination, which is a result of somebody not wanting to pull up with bureaucratic garbage or people not doing their jobs or being shady.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, if you're a cop who doesn't get along well with other cops, I'm going to trust you more than most cops.
Same. That was the exact reaction I had.
Yep.
Like, if you can't figure out how to navigate in that environment, then you probably are still a decent human being.
Yep.
So... The next is him and Butters take the show on the road.
I love the way that you say that. What show? The Butters is scared and Harry has to talk him down show?
Well, it's also like Butters is going on and on about how cool this SUV is. And he's like super impressed by the CD changer.
I love, like, real dated shit like that. Mm-hmm. Somebody's impressed by some, like, I think we talked about Willow in Buffy talking about something having, like, 200 megabytes of memory. And you're just like, oh, God.
Yeah, he's like, oh, it's got onboard GPS because I guess smartphones with GPS just weren't a thing yet.
Yep.
And then when they try to use it, it tells them, oh, my God.
Entering so Helsinki.
Because that just came up earlier for us.
Yes, it did. Helsinki syndrome, guys. I said that. It's not a real thing, PD Tubbs. So, also, I like the fact that it doesn't work for them, but also, if you've ever tried to use onboard GPS, that shit almost never works anyway.
I can't remember the the last time I was in a car that fucking had that chick that somebody tried to use. I swear to God, it's been so long. Do you remember OnStar?
Oh, yeah.
Like, that was, like, the real fancy pants shit, you know?
Yeah, if you got in a crash, they would, like, call you. Mm-hmm. And be like, is everything okay? And you'd be like, OnStar.
I got offered a job to work for them. They had, if not OnStar, a competitor who wasn't nearly as successful, and that's why I can't remember their name, operations center when I lived in Charlotte. And I got a job being one of those people that answer, like, calls and shit. Mm-hmm. But I didn't take it because I didn't like the hours. But good thing, too, because they probably went out of business immediately after.
Oh, true, huh? But, yeah, this kind of thing is, like, you know, when it's on your phone, all of that stuff is just so much more adaptable. Like, if roads change, if there's a detour that you need to take, like, Google compensates for all of that so quickly. But, like, Owen's grandparents have some really nice cars with older GPS systems because they came, like, so, you know, they aren't as, I keep wanting to say sprightly.
As adaptive?
Adaptive isn't the word I want. Like,
intuitive?
No, it's like sprightly? Nimble. They're not as nimble. I said sprightly already. How dare you?
I just said it again to be a dick.
I hate you. They're not as nimble. And yeah, you try and type shit in and they're like, start with the zip code, please. Who the fuck ever knows the zip code of the place they want to go? You need to get on your phone to find out that information. Then just use your phone to navigate. Holy shit. Like, that kind of thing irritates the shit out of me. And then they send you to the wrong place, which theirs did. And it mm-hmm. sent us, like, 40 minutes out of our way to a place that was nothing.
Listen, I still give the zip code if I use Uber. Mm-hmm. Because it's happened to me, like, 3 separate times where, like, I live in Drexel Hill. And I live on Woodland Avenue, mm-hmm. but there is also a Woodland Avenue in the city proper. Ah. So I've been in an Uber and they dropped me off at 42nd and Woodland in West Philly. And I'm like, this isn't right. this is all wrong.
No. It's already happened.
And I've had it happen to me taking an Uber in Jersey somewhere where the same road had the same address. It just depended on which township you were in. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't put the zip code in, so they took me to the fucking wrong one. So yeah, I'm like an old lady. I'm like, oh, I know the zip code. Let me give you that.
Oh my God. Yeah, I mean, it's just, this is a stupid thing to get hung up on, but I always think of the scene in, was it The Office, where he just sails the machine nose and drives into the lake?
Yes.
Is that the one? The machine knows. It's a good moment.
That's the episode he's so mad because he's fighting the machine because fucking the temp, Ryan, wants to, like, update the website and let, like, you know, customers order online and shit. And Michael's right. like, no. And he just gives up. He's like, the machine knows. Ryan's right. And they end up in the fucking place.
So it ends up with this little phrase that is on some of the Dresden t-shirts that I saw on TeePublic, which is, life is a journey, time is a river, the door is ajar. Which is one of my favorite little things. So yeah, Harry is bringing Butters to the, what do you call it? Morgue, basically. Forensic Institute.
Dude, I hate that. I really don't like that.
Neither does Harry. I kind of like that you guys are, like, on the same side with that. And Butters is like, why are we doing this? And Harry's like, listen, nobody got in touch with you. We haven't heard anything in the news. I asked Rawlins and Rawlins didn't know. Apparently, whatever happened to Phil has been covered up. They don't mm-hmm. know about it. And they needed you specifically for something. And they came to the morgue So whatever it was that Gravain's after has to do with that body, right? Like, that was the only body that had anything suspicious going on. So we got to look at it. We got to investigate it. And when they get there, sure enough, like, the dude at the front is just like, hey, have you seen Phil? Like,
this is so... This conversation is so awkward.
Right?
Because this guy just won't let it go. I keep waiting for Butters to be like, I said, I haven't seen him.
I love watching Butters try to be casual as he's lying. Because he's just like, he makes me so nervous.
Oh my God.
You know, I just, he's doing his best. It's not like he's like, I can't lie. He's not being an asshole about what he has to do, but it's just not something that comes naturally to him at all. So it's just really hard to watch. And the cop, like, can tell it's not, you know, he doesn't know what's going on. I don't think he really suspects Butters, but right. He can tell the dude's lying.
That something is off.
Yeah. So that also, like, Butters, after he walks away, he knows, like, Butters is flipping out. But yeah, so they go to examine the body, and finally Butters is like, all right, I'm going to have to do some stuff that's going to require some equipment. You need to go wait because you're going to fuck shit up for me. And Harry goes and waits outside in the, like, lobby area. And this is when he sees the new baddies.
Also, there's, they get there and they find out that Bartlesby is already there.
Right. And
then from the museum.
Dr. Brioche has taken the case himself.
Right.
Which Butters is kind of like, oh, wow. Then this has been given priority treatment for some reason.
New baddies. Butters' sign. He was like, if there's any trouble, I'll give you a sign.
Oh my God, I forgot about her.
I'll imitate the scream of a terrified little girl.
Oh, that's so good.
Butters really is the best.
Isn't he great? I just love him. And the voice that that James Marsters does for him, Harry, what do you mean? Do I need to go in there? I'll imitate the scream of a terrified little girl. Like, it's this real nasal sort of, it's really fun. It's very distinctive. And there's a short story, like, from his point of view on something. And then it's not James Marsters narrating that one. And the guy they got for that is also excellent. So I think I have warm feelings towards Butters because everybody who does the voices for him is really, really good. So yeah, Alicia and Li Xiang. These two are an unknown quantity. We know they're baddies, clearly, because we find out that Li Xiang cut steaks from the quadriceps of the dead man for lunch.
When they come in and they're doing their spiel with the guy at the desk. You know, we're very important. We're here to get, you know, these personal items. And Casey, the security guard or the cop on duty, is just like, well, first of all, that's not how any of this works.
Yep.
You're not even supposed to be here. How do you even know about any of this? It hasn't been released to the public.
Yep.
And Harry is just, you know, listening with a capital L, trying to see what's going on. And he catches a face. Is it fair to call it a face?
A ripple?
Faces?
I feel like a ripple.
A ripple in the veneer of the fake face?
Yeah.
Which was really creepy. And I had to read it twice. Because I was like, wait, what? Because I didn't feel like I had, I mean, the cops might have suspected them, but I really didn't feel like we had that much to go on, you know, to think that his traveling companions would be the ones who did him in, Bartlesby, I mean, you know.
Right.
So, yeah, I was unprepared for the face to move.
For something to move around under his skin.
Yeah, I wasn't prepared.
Yeah, that's fair.
And she, you know, they're having this little argument, her and Lee. And she just puts a stop to all his back talk.
He's not being respectful.
Mm-mm. She shuts that shit down.
And she calls him, her, my lord.
Yeah, he does.
So, I guess it's a he in her body? Or maybe, like, lord is, like, not a gendered title in whatever?
I was thinking it wasn't gendered.
Okay.
I mean, I could be wrong. I just leapt right to that.
Yeah.
And it was more of a acknowledgement of her status than, you know, calling her, like, my lady, you know.
Yeah, I really do enjoy, too. I know it's, like, such a dumb, petty thing, but I do like that in Dresden Files, he kind of, like, he being Butcher, does try and deal with the fact that certain things wouldn't be allowed that is often let go by other writers or in TV shows and whatnot. Like, a total stranger will come in and, like, oh, I'm checking on the status of so-and-so. And, like, you can't really do that. If you go into a place and you don't have ID and you're not, you know, you're not somebody who's related.
Right.
They don't just tell you somebody's status or what room he's in or whatever. Like, right. You need to be somebody who deserves to know.
Yep.
And that's something I feel like in so much stuff I see, that information is just given. And it's a big deal because we need the characters to be able to get to them.
Exactly. It's like, you know, to further the plot, we'll just pretend like these little things don't matter.
Mm-hmm.
And in the grand scale, they don't. But it adds, it lends a bit of a...
realism? You
know, when he does it, it lends realism to the story. And then when writers don't do it, it takes away. You know, you're just like, that's not really how that shit works.
Yep.
You know?
And this cop is not only like, first of all, that's not how this works, but it seems like the fact that she's doing this has roused his suspicions some.
Yeah, because she's got all kinds of paperwork. Like, she's got a power of attorney, mm-hmm. which in real life would not matter in this situation. You know, you don't show up to the morgue before the autopsy is done to collect the effects. You know, they package that shit up, and then a cop on the case will let you pick up that stuff. You know,
okay.
But she has all this paperwork, and he takes it and takes it upstairs, but he doesn't give them access to the body. He's like, mm-hmm. y'all can wait here while I go check on this.
Yeah.
And then comes back and says, no, he's busy.
You and can wait for just an
hour and a half.
I'll wait then.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so annoyed about it, and I love it.
Right. But, you know, it doesn't just magically open up all these doors for her, you know, just because she showed up and, you know, said she needed to do a thing. Which a lot of writers, I think, really would have been like, okay, right this way, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. And it's also kind of great because you're seeing fucking monsters get stymied by human bureaucracy, which is super
How
fun.
How frustrating that must be for
you, you know? And obviously, Lee Xian is like, hey, I could just, like, follow that fucking guard and eat him, and then we'd be done. And she's like, you fucking idiot.
Right.
That would attract so much attention. What are you even... why are you even here? Like, she starts to just...
she says something to him, too, about... she's so exasperated with him.
Yep.
She says, we wouldn't even be here if you... what'd she say? If you could control your stomach? Or something? She says, stop thinking with your stomach.
Stop thinking with your stomach. And he says, we aren't here if just because I stopped to eat, if you had been able to keep yourself from, like, playing around. He says something like that. Like, if you hadn't indulged yourself.
Yeah, if you hadn't indulged yourself, yeah. Which I'm just like, ooh, what are they talking about?
Yeah.
He stopped to eat, she indulged herself, and what exactly?
Yeah.
Probably nothing
Don't
good.
Don't want to know. Thanks. I'm good. Go ahead.
I was going to say, yeah, but then this is where it breaks down, and she's just like, I've had enough of your shit.
Mm-hmm. And Harry, you know, with a lot of foresight, he left his cane in the examination room that Butters is in.
Why is Harry acting like this is his first day on the job?
But that's why he did it on purpose. So that he goes to the guard and is like, I left my cane back in Butters' office. Is it okay if I go and get it? That's what he uses as his excuse.
Well, yeah, I didn't. Oh, that's pretty smart, dude. I apologize.
Oh, you have my deepest, excuses.
Basically. Yeah, I knew he went. You had to tell the Casey that, but I really did think it was just an oversight that he left it in there.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, he goes in and tells Butters, like, you need to finish this up, and we need to go because there are some people here that want to get at this body or the body of what's his face, and we can't be doing this. And so they're like about to just go, and then Harry realizes who this Mendoza character is. He goes by the name Bony Tony, and he's a smuggler.
Mm-hmm.
Who works for John Marcone.
How about that?
Like, he's a freelancer, but he works for John enough that he's considered one of his guys.
Right.
And that he had a trick for smuggling shit in, which was to put it in a baggie, swallow it, and the baggie would be tied to a back tooth so that he could just grab the string and pull it up from his gullet. Don't care for that. Don't like it. Like,
better than pooping it out.
Is it?
I would think so.
I feel like, I mean, I'm sure, you know, with practice, but I just, the feeling of, like, suffocation that I feel like you'd experience as you're yanking it through your esophagus. That's just a hard thing for me to be okay with. And, yeah, no. So, Harry tells Butters to check that, and Butters does, and lo and behold, there is a thumb drive
mm-hmm.
in a condom tied to his back tooth. And Butters tries to hand it to Harry, who is like, fucking get it away from me, oh my god. Like, he freaks out a little bit.
Yeah, and then Butters immediately feelings. Feels bad.
mm-hmm. Oh, Butters, you precious flower.
Yeah. And it's a very Butters thing to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, just in that moment of not really thinking. And then Butters gets sidetracked with the air quotes science behind why Harry has this impact on electronics.
Yep. And I Harry enjoy that, because Harry's, like, yelling at Butters about, like, getting sidetracked, but then the next chapter starts with Harry off on a train of thought, and Butters having to be like, Harry,
right,
like,
right.
Come back to Earth. So he just said that, and then he does that shit. So I enjoy that a lot. So Harry tells him to hold on to it, and they can't access it because they don't have the right ports on the computer that Butters has. So they're going to need to go to Georgia and Billy's place.
But first, they have to grab something.
What do they have to grab?
Butters' polka machine.
Oh, his my whole God, I forgot get up. About this. I love that you just call it a polka machine. Yeah, that seems fair.
And when Harry at first is like, we don't have time for this. The look on Butters' face, I imagine, is just so crestfallen. But Harry is just like, okay, fine.
He's crushed.
So they're trying to sneak out the bag, but they have to carry this thing with them.
Yup.
This thing that exists just to make a lot of noise.
Oh, Butters, you precious baby. Don't ever change. I would love to see this on film. Like, there are certain things about Dresden Files that just seem really cinematic in terms of, like, being epic and grandiose and how mm-hmm. cool the effects would be. But this is a scene I just want to see because of how funny it would be.
It seems very cartoonish to me.
Oh, my
He
God.
Says it takes up most of the back seat of the SUV.
Yep. I like to think that if he had the Beetle, he couldn't even, like, fit it in there.
Oh, they would have had to leave it.
I love that. So he manages, like, they, I like it ends with him being like, we are not taking that with us. And then the next paragraph opens with, it took up most of the bag. Like, he just resigns himself finally. So they go to the werewolf's place and they open up the thumb drive and all that's on it is a bunch of numbers.
Yeah. It's like 16 numbers, which I was like, oh, well, that's gotta be a credit card, right?
That's a, I'm sure exactly what I thought too. If you don't think it's a credit card, like, cause that's where my mind jumped to also, what do you think it is? Do you have any like, theories on what these numbers are?
Oh God, no, I'm never good at stuff like that.
Okay.
Coordinates, you know what I mean?
You it disappeared be, there. What'd you say?
Oh, it could be like coordinates, you know?
Mm.
It could be a combination to something, to a lock of some sort, or, I mean, who the fuck knows? When it comes to things like that, oh, it's just a series of numbers. Shit could literally be anything.
It's true. So Harry, like, stops and, because I think he was hoping that getting this information was going to be, like, the break he needed to figure out what to do next. Because once he realizes that he can't do anything with this information at this moment, he doesn't know what to do.
Right. You know? So he decides to check his messages.
Yep.
Yep. And that takes us to the next part of the story.
Oh, Murphy. She wanted me to water her plants. How coy. How sexy.
Thanks for taking care of my pants.
Plants! My plants! Stop that!
Right. I love that right as he is thinking about, because as she's leaving her message, Karen, there's like a high-pitched squeal, and she's talking to, obviously, to, motherfucker, what's his
Kincaid.
Name? Kincaid, thank
John
you.
McCain, I think we all know is his name.
And Harry is just sort of like, wonder why she was laughing like that. And then he gets a message from Sheila, right on time.
Yeah, to distract him from this other, this faithless broad. Ran off with a half demon dude. So what's your feeling on Sheila?
Right now I'm not super interested in her. Mm-hmm. Not her fault, you know. What he did here as far as having her because the message is just that, you know, something weird happened. She's not really sure if it means anything. You know, yeah. I might be crazy, but if you could stop by, that'd be great. And of course, you know, it's a woman in distress. And also, he doesn't know what the fuck else to do with himself right now.
Right.
So, of course, he goes. And I just feel like I want this story to keep moving forward. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get bogged down in a lot of Harry Dresden lady nonsense if it's not going to be important to the story.
That's and I'm fair.
Not, you know, I'm not convinced yet. It's really early with Sheila anyway, so maybe it will turn into something. But it better just not be some dame to take up space.
Yeah, I have to say, like, when I first read this, my feeling was, because she basically is like, I don't know, oh, I probably sound crazy, but if you could just come by the shop, and I'm like, just tell him what it is. Why does he have to go to the shop to talk to you about this thing? Like, you are in your message right now making it sound like, oh, you know what, it was probably nothing. Which makes me feel like, you know what? It probably was nothing. Just say what it is on the phone.
Right.
And
right.
If it seems like it's of interest to him, then he can come and talk to you more and question you and whatever. And invest, like, if whatever it is that happened at the shop, like she says, I think that something's wrong at the shop. So, like, you can't get more detail than that. Like, this is just the kind of thing that as a, a storyteller, I understand wanting people to go see each other in person, and TV does this too. But like, holy shit, just say it on the phone. Yeah. You don't need to do this, you know?
So, I mean, so he's gonna go.
You sound so thrilled.
I'm trying to withhold judgment. I am apparently not doing a great job at that. but yeah. I will say though, so far in these books, even when he does this thing where he introduces a lady character for our hero, Jim Butcher does tend to make it pan out at the end. You know, I'm thinking of Susan right now, mm-hmm. and I'm trying to remember how kind of like not here for her I was.
That's
at
true.
One point.
Yeah.
So, excuse me, maybe he's earned a little bit more trust. Maybe I should give him that.
Well, we are on book 8. So, I feel like if you're going to start giving him the benefit of the doubt,
this would be a good time to do it.
I feel like this is it. Yeah, we're officially like halfway through a 16-book series. If you don't have faith in him yet, that's a bad sign.
Yeah. You know what it is, too? I think it's because it's not so much how he treats the women or whether they end up becoming important to the story or just like interesting characters in their own right. Mm-hmm. It's the way he introduces them that still leaves a bad taste in my mouth.
Agreed.
That just makes me roll my eyes.
Yeah.
So I'll split the blame with Jim Butcher on that.
All right. Yeah, I think that, like, I'm glad to hear you say that, to be honest, because there were times where I would get so frustrated and I would wonder, is it just me? Am I just being oversensitive to this? But it really irritates me that it's always the same sort of like, hello there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there's a thing. Oh, I might need her for something. Oh, she's being helpful, but hello.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
can we just not?
Right.
And
even like when he's being self-aware, because there's like a couple lines about how it's a damsel and, you know, I can't resist that. I'm like, but it's book 8. Maybe you could resist it a little bit. Mm-hmm. You are, you know, you seem aware of this behavior and this way of thinking. There's no rule that says you can't change that.
Yeah. I think that it's supposed to be, oh, that's his fatal flaw.
Oh, come on.
Which it is, you know, like, honestly, I had a bit of a, one of the books that I got commissioned to read for Spoil Me, the first 50 pages, was for this book series called Iron Druid, and the first book in it is called Hounded. So I read the first 50 pages, and it's very Dresden-y, and it's fun and funny, but there is like this, the only weakness he has is beautiful women. Yeah. And you're just like, no, come on. It's just really like, you know, and whatever, it's fine. Sure, go ahead. I'm just going to start writing stories with female main characters, and their weakness is dick.
I was going to say well-hung men, right?
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't resist a well-hung man.
Dickmatized.
I mean, who could? Dickmatized. I haven't heard that in forever.
Yeah, that was something I heard all the time during the that run of The Walking Dead. Like, when Laurie goes and hangs out with the governor. Do you remember that whole storyline? Not Laurie, the other one.
Oh, Andrea.
Andrea, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And everybody just would call her Dickmatized all the time, which was not inaccurate, frankly. Don't do that. Don't push me away. Shut up. You don't know this man.
You just met him.
Ugh, so irritating.
After wandering around in the wilderness for how long?
I love that anytime I want to bring up something that I find annoying in storytelling, The Walking Dead is there for me.
Well, that's what they do, right?
That is
like
what
the one
they
purpose
do.
They serve.
They are an example of how not to handle shit. So that's the end. It's just like him being like, all right, I'm going to go do this, and you guys need to bring Butters back to my place. And Butters is like, I don't get it. We just, you know, they don't need me anymore. And he's like, dummy, we know that they can't use you anymore. They don't know that. They right. don't know that we found, they don't know anything. Of course,
they're still Butters is like, so I'm done here, right? I go home.
Oh my God.
This is all over for me, right?
Yep.
Nope. I'm sorry.
For he just wants to go home.
I would want to go home too. I also love that Butters feels very much like a proxy for the reader.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what if you just ended up in Harry Dresden's life?
Yeah, he tells Harry, like, if you're feeling like you need to protect my ego and keep me involved, you don't need to worry about that. I'm fine with hiding. I like hiding, even. Hiding is great for me. Like, yeah, so.
That's what I mean about the Butters and Harry show.
It's yes, that's fair.
They have great banter. I enjoy them, too.
Agreed. All right, so I'm going to say hi to new patrons, and I'm going to tell you guys about some of the stuff I've got coming up for Spoil Me, because I think some of you may be interested in that. So new patrons this week are Roger, Lady Howlett, Toasted Toad, Shefali Vasudevan, Colette Smith, Jason Butler. No, Jason's not new. I lied. Yeah, get out of here, Jason. I don't need you. That's not true. Thanks, Jason. Rebecca Felderman, Robin Patinall, Sig Strada, and Crystal Powell, Chelsea Mayo. Chelsea's been around, too. This is giving me all the wrong information. JB, and that's it. So welcome to all of you. Thank you all so much for pledging. And make sure to join the Facebook group for patrons. Also, Miles and I are finally starting to wrap up on Dark Tower. There's only two more episodes before we are done with that series. And then he and I are going to be starting Black Mirror Seasons 3 and 4, which will be for $5 and up patrons. So if you're interested in that, become a $5 patron. And that shit will be available to $1 and up patrons once we are completely finished. So, you know, not until like spring of next year. So if you're interested in following it along as we're posting them, you'll need to be $5 and up. But I'm really excited because everybody's been talking about Black Mirror and, you know, how good it's been. And there is a Christmas episode that we never covered, which we're going to save for Christmas time. So that should be fun. But, yeah, so everything that's going on with fucking Spoil Me. Guys, I'm blowing up. I was not ready. And I'm delighted. Because I really, like, I started the Spoil Me project kind of being like, well, I guess we'll see how this goes, you know. And everybody was like, oh, you're doing what now? No, yeah, I want some of that, please. And so I've been pelted with commissions. The most, like, prolific one so far is for Veronica Mars.
I am not surprised.
I have 7 episodes sponsored. I've only covered the first 2. It looks like everybody who's booking them is having me do the crowdcasts on Tuesday evenings, early evening, because I have another recording at night on Tuesdays. So if you're interested in going to those crowdcasts and participating in the conversation, check Facebook for events or check the website unspokenpodcast.com/events. Also, I have gotten the first 2 sections of So You Want to Be a Wizard commissioned, and I covered the second section on Monday, and it was really fun, and it's a really bizarre, like, magic mythology, like, the way they do magic and how magic works is so strange. So that really surprised me. And then Rosalie has decided she's going to sponsor all of this book called Sunshine, and it is really good and really surprising. It's like, oh, it's another book about witches and werewolves and vampires and demons, but it's done in a much more like self-aware and fun way, and it's much more unexpected, and there isn't like sexy vampire man, like that's not a thing. So I've been really enjoying that. I'm delighted, really, that everything people have asked me to cover so far has been really good, and I've really enjoyed it. Genuinely have. Like, I'm not just saying that. And I mentioned before Iron Druid, which I also really did enjoy, despite his one fatal weakness being beautiful women. Womp womp. But, you know, other than that. And then on Monday, the 27th, I will be doing the first 50 pages of Fire and Hemlock by Diana Wynne Jones. The only thing I read by her was for the book club, and it was Howl's Moving Castle. And on the 31st, I'm going to be covering Pan's Labyrinth, which I have never seen and kind of avoided because it's got torture in it, and I'm not good with that. But yeah, Melanie Linares, she commissioned that episode and convinced me that I could do it and get through it. So thank you, Melanie. And I think that's about it right now, but that's plenty to be getting on with.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just really excited about how excited everybody else is. And I'm excited that everybody's got really good taste.
Yeah. All your picks so far have been really good.
Yeah.
So I guess thank your, what do you call people who commission stuff? Commissioners? That doesn't
sponsors.
Seem right. Wait,
I
what?
I kind of call them sponsors in my
sponsors,
head.
Sponsors. Okay.
But, yeah, I'll say like this episode was sponsored by, you know, so yeah, I think that's about it. Is there anything you want to add? I know that there isn't usually, but...
There isn't this time either.
All right. That's easy. All right, guys. Well, thank you all so much for listening. Make sure to check out patreon.com/unspoiled if you're interested in becoming a patron. And if you want to see how I felt about some of the stuff that I have covered for Spoil Me, you can find that on iTunes. It's its own feed, the Spoil Me feed. So, and that's it. All right. We'll see you next week. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Spoiled Network Podcast.